This conference will now be recorded.
Good morning, everyone. Am I audible to you? Okay, everyone, put your attendance in the chat box. Today we are going to discuss about malaria. The term malaria is derived from Italian word mal air, which means bad air. Who discovered a malaria parasite? Ronald Ross. It is mainly caused by five species of the Plasmodium protozoa: Plasmodium falciparum, vivax, ovale, malaria, and Nowlesi. So malaria is transmitted through the bite of an infected female Anopheles mosquito. These are the regions of the world where malaria is prevalent. You can see India totally in blue color. Some areas like New Zealand and Greenland, they are not infected by malaria. It is the world's most devastating human parasitic infection. Malaria affects over 40% of the world's population. In India only 2 million cases and 1,000 deaths per year occur due to malaria. Life cycle of malaria. You know that it starts with mosquito bite. Whenever the mosquito bites, the sporozoites enter into the bloodstream, which reach the liver capsule, and there in the liver they form exoerythrocytic cycle, where they invade the hepatic cells and they form merozoites, and then the erythrocytic phase starts. Finally, gametocytes will come, and the mosquito which is biting us, gametocytes will enter, and they will develop into sexual phase, and the cycle continues. So sexual phase occurs in mosquito, whereas the sexual phase occurs in humans. So exogenous sexual phase in the mosquito is called sporogony, during which the parasite multiplies. The endogenous asexual phase occurring in the humans is called schizogony, sporogony and schizogony. This is a classical life cycle picture. Initially, after the mosquito bite, what happens? The sporozoites enter into the liver cell, where it forms exoerythrocytic cycle. Sporozoites form schizonts. Whenever the schizonts are multiplying, the liver cell bursts, and that is called ruptured schizont. Then merozoites enter into the blood, which infect the RBCs, that is erythrocytic cycle, where the merozoites are transformed to trophozoites, pink stage, mature stage, and again they form the schizonts. Some trophozoites form gametocytes, whereas others continue in this erythrocytic cycle. The ones which form gametocytes, the gametocytes are present in the bloodstream, peripheral blood, and again it helps in infecting the other mosquitoes. In the mosquitoes, they form oocinate after the fusion of microgamete and macrogamete. Oocinate converts into oocyst. The oocinate comes to the salivary glands of the mosquito, and there the sporozoites are released. In microbiology, you will learn all this anyway. So man is the intermediate host and mosquito is the definitive host. So what is the pre-erythrocytic cycle period? So for the symptoms to occur, the infection should occur to the RBC. So erythrocytic phase symptoms will occur. So before that, there is a pre-erythrocytic cycle, which defines like incubation period only almost. Plasmodium vivax, it is 8 days. Falciparum, it is 6 days. So falciparum occurs more earlier, much earlier than. Malaria is 13 to 16 days. Ovale is 9 days. The liver schizons rupture and they form merozoites. The merozoites release invade the red cells. And some species have predilection to different age group of erythrocytes. Vivax mostly infects the newly formed RBCs, young erythrocytes, whereas malaria infects old erythrocytes. But falciparum infects RBC of all ages. The other difference is Plasmodium malariae or Falciparum sporozoites do not form hypnozoites. Hypno means something is hiding. Hypno. Hypnozoites are not there in Falciparum and malaria. So the remote infection will not happen. So these patients directly develop into pre-erythrocytic schizons in the liver. As I told, gametogony, merozoites differentiate into male and female gametocytes that are developed in the red cells and found in the peripheral blood smears. Sexual cycle starts with gametocytes in the female Anopheles mosquito. After fertilization, it forms zygote, which matures into oocyanate, oocyanate to oocyst. Oocyst contains many large number of sporozoites. So vivax is basically a tertian malaria. What is tertian malaria? So fever will occur on every third day. So for every 48 hours there will be fever. It is a somewhat benign condition. The relapse may occur because, as I told, only malaria and falciparum do not have hypnozoites. Others like vivax, novalacea, ovale, they all have hypnozoites. So relapse may occur because of dormant hypnozoites residing in the liver. Plasmodium malariae causes quartan malaria. That means for every 72 hour cycle it happens. So every fourth day the patient will develop a fever. There is no exoerythrocytic stage, but relapse may occur. Plasmodium falciparum causes malignant tertian malaria. It is called malignant because most of the falciparum infections are severe form of malaria. Infected RBC forms clusters called rosettes. Why only Plasmodium falciparum can cause severe malaria compared to vivax and ovale? Why only falciparum causes malignant malaria? Because falciparum has a ability to produce RBC clusters. So whenever the RBC are infected with the Plasmodium falciparum, they will secrete some enzymes so that the RBCs will adhere to each other and they form a rosettes. So such rosettes block the capillaries of vital organs. So if they block the renal capillaries, they develop renal failure. If it blocks the cerebral vessels, it forms encephalopathy. So severe form of malaria is usually seen in Plasmodium falciparum. What is the reason? Reason is due to formation of RBC clusters or rosettes. The incubation period is around 9 to 14 days. What are the early symptoms? The common first symptom is fever, headache, chills, vomiting after 10 to 15 days of infection. If they are not treated promptly, then malaria can cause severe illness, which is fatal. So everyone should learn about malaria at least. Common in our areas. clinically there are some stages in during stage 1, which is a cold stage, there will be chills for 15 minutes to 1 hour. It is due to rupture of host red cells. And stage 2 is hot stage, when after rupture of the blood cells, the merozoites enter the stream, then cytokines will come. Whenever cytokines and interleukins come, there will be fever. Fever may reach up to 40 degrees. It lasts several hours and start invading nerve cells. Whenever these merozoites and trophozoites are in the bloodstream, there will be fever. And again, within 48 hours, they will enter the RBC and there will not be any fever. Again, they will develop the next cycle. So every third day, there will be fever. Stage 3 is sweating stage. It is nothing but convalescent. Whenever the fever subsides, patient will have sweating. The Plasmodium malariae fever can last for 8 hours or more, and temperature may exceed 41 degrees. So previously they used to tell a cold stage, when our patient feels chills, they will cover with the blankets and all, and then it comes to the hot stage, then they will feel very hot. So then the sweating stage, patient will develop profuse sweating. So this is a classical scenario, but what happens is the patients will have mixed symptoms. Not every case will be classical, like every third day fever should occur or these stages should present. That is all classic description, but in common clinical practice, it will be a mixed pattern. Patient can develop anyway fever anytime, or patient will not follow any tertian or quartan thing. So in historic period, when there is no treatment for malaria and the investigations are very less to identify, these clinical patterns are very important. So whenever they have this quartan fever, they will think of malaria or falciparum, and if there is tertian fever, they will think of vivax. But in nowadays, when there is treatment, these patterns are usually not seen. So what is severe complicated malaria? There will be any of these symptoms can be present in the patient. There will be confusion or drowsiness with extreme weakness. In addition, they may develop alteration in the level of consciousness. They will develop coma. Cerebral malaria. How will you define cerebral malaria? It is an unarousable coma, not attributable to any other cause, in a patient with falciparum malaria. Patient will develop seizures and he will go into coma for more than 30 minutes, and patient will not arouse. We cannot wake the patient. There can be respiratory distress. Due to renal failure, they can develop metabolic acidosis with bicarbonate of less than 15 milliequivalents per liter. Then they will develop respiratory distress due to severe acidosis and multiple generated convulsions. There can be seizures, 2 or more episodes within 1 day period. There can be circulatory shock. Patient develops hypotension and circulatory collapse. There may be pulmonary edema or abnormal bleeding. Platelets can be reduced in malaria. So there can be abnormal bleeding due to thrombocytopenia or due to disseminated intravascular coagulopathy. Or whenever it infects the liver cells, so it can cause jaundice and hemoglobinuria, that is called black water fever, because patients will have urine in black color due to presence of hemoglobin. And there can be acute renal failure presenting as oliguria or anuria. There can be severe anemia, HB less than 5 gram per deciliter or hematocrit less than 15% is for severe anemia. And there can be high fever or hypoglycemic episodes. So whenever the patient comes with confusion, drowsiness, and any one of these symptoms, you can classify them as severe complicated malaria. So it can be cerebral malaria or severe anemia or renal failure and others. You can classify three severe manifestations. Mainly we have to remember is cerebral malaria, anemia and renal failure. These are common, and others are there: hepatic dysfunction, hypoglycemia, shock. Whenever there is shock, it is called allergic malaria. Like black water fever is hemoglobinuria. Like that shock is allergic malaria. Highest mortality is for cerebral malaria, which is around 20%. Out of 100 people who develop cerebral malaria, 20 patients will end up dying. But with successful treatment, there will be complete recovery. Permanent disability is very rare. Even though patient goes into coma and recurrent seizures, there will not be any chronic sequelae. Patient will be recovering completely. And severe anemia may be fatal unless a blood transfusion is given. And renal failure is main treatment is continuous rehydration and peritoneal dialysis. It is associated with bad prognosis. So why are falciparum, we are more worried about falciparum infections, why? Because they can produce fatal complications like cerebral malaria, malarial hyperpyrexia, GI disorders, allergic malaria or black water fever. What is pernicious malaria? It is a life-threatening complication in acute falciparum malaria due to heavy parasitization. It can manifest as cerebral malaria or allergic malaria. So basically the cerebral malaria patient will present with hyperpyrexia. Can you turn off the mics? Some disturbance in there. Okay. So what is the pathogenesis of cerebral malaria? As I already told you, falciparum can form, they have a tendency to form the RBC rosettes or clusters, which can block the, that is called RBC sequestration. All the RBCs are sequestered in the capillaries due to clustering. So this can cause high cytokine levels, which will further lead to more sequestration of the infected RBC. This is the RBC rosette or cluster seen in falciparum. So what happens whenever the RBCs are moving in clusters in the spleen? What will happen? These RBC clusters will be broken down and blood corpuscles are destroyed. Then the hemoglobin goes into the blood, which is excreted in the urine. That's due to hemoglobin in the urine. There will be dark and cola-colored urine. So how long it can last without treatment? Falciparum will terminate in less than 1 year. So all for clearing all the trophozoites, gametocytes and all, it will take less than 1 year without treatment. But in vivax and ovale, there will be hypnozoites, which will be in the liver cells. So it will take more than up to 5 years it can present. Relapses can be present. In malaria, it is around 40 years. Recrudescence, it is called recrudescence. So how do you diagnose malaria? So whenever the patient comes with severe high grade fever, which lasts for less than a week, and there is associated prostration, or then you have to think of malaria. First investigations you order is, you can go for blood film examination. There will be thin smear and thick smears, or there can be QBC system. Nowadays we are using RDT, rapid diagnostic test, like CAR test you might have seen. Just you put a drop of blood and we can find out whether you have malaria or not. Or there can be PCR, polymerase chain reaction. So these are thick and thin smears. So what is the importance? Which one do you prefer or since we are? Which one do you prefer? So thick smears are mainly for there will be blood in concentration. So you can identify the parasitemia. Whereas thin smears, it is mainly for species identification. We have to stain with Jimsa stain to give the parasites a distinct appearance. It is a gold standard for confirmation of the malaria. So this is how the Plasmodium ovale trophozoite looks like under the microscope. Oval cells with Schuffner's dots or James dots within the RBC. So after that, there is a QBC system, which is the simplest and most sensitive method for diagnosing malaria, babesiosis. So not only malaria, QBC system can diagnose other diseases also, like babesiosis, trypanosomiasis, filariasis, and relapsing fever or borreliosis. All these diseases can be diagnosed by QBC system. So this is the classical appearance of malaria parasite in QBC. Nowadays there is antigen detection or rapid diagnostic tests, which you already know about it. So there will be, these are immunochromatographic tests based on the detection of specific parasite antigens. So the cards will be coated with the antibodies. So you will coat with the Plasmodium vivax antibody and falciparum, whichever is common in your area. So whenever the blood reacts with that antibody, if there is a presence of antigen, it will show the line, positive line. So there are two types of tests, CAR tests. They are histidine-rich protein, HRP2 kit, and LDH, lactate dehydrogenase kit. These two antigens are detected in the RDT, rapid diagnostic test. Commonly we use is histidine-rich protein, HRP. So with newer diagnostic methods, there can be, we can directly diagnose, detect by detecting the nucleic acids with PCR technique. This is more accurate than microscopy, but it is very expensive. So we'll not use it commonly. Most sensitive test is antibody detection by RDT. So malaria relapses in Plasmodium vivax and ovale patients having recovered from the first episode of illness may suffer with several additional attacks or relapses. These are mainly due to presence of hypnozoites in the liver cells. So how do you manage malaria? What is the drug therapy? Previously we used to have monotherapies, but now we are switching to combination therapies to prevent the development of resistance. So if there is an uncomplicated malaria patient, the treatment of choice will be chloroquine. If it is chloroquine sensitive, we have to give chloroquine. Otherwise, in some areas which is already chloroquine resistant areas, will be the endemic areas, there you can go with ACT combinations, artesunate. The artemisinin derivative components of the combination must be given for at least 3 days. We can give oral medication. So these are the combinations, artesunate combinations. These combinations you have to remember. Artemether with lumefantrine, or artesunate with amodioquine, or artesunate with mefloquine, or artesunate with sulfadioxin pyrimethamine, ASP, or dihydro artemisinin plus piperaquine. Commonly we use ASP combination or artemether lumefantrine. These are the common available regimens in our areas. So you have to remember artemether is lumefantrine, artesunate is amodiaquine or mefloquine or sulfadoxin pyrimethamine. These therapies should be used in preference to sulfadoxin pyrimethamine plus amodiaquine. So all the preparations contain artemether. The second line treatment is alternative ACT. You can give artesunate with tetracycline or doxycycline or clindamycin. These are the other combinations which we don't use now. It can be given for 7 days. Or the secondary drug, another secondary drug is quinine. In olden days, they used to use quinine for malaria, but due to more side effects, QT prolongation and all, nowadays we are not using quinine. So we are confused how to treat. So many combinations are there. So the patient has Plasmodium vivax or oval infection, and the area is chloroquine sensitive, then we can give chloroquine. These doses you have to remember, very easy. Chloroquine doses, total dose will be 25 mg per kg body weight. We have to give it in three doses. Easy method is, out of 25, first day you give 10, second day you give 10, and third day you give 5 mg per kg. 10 mg per kg, 10 mg per kg, and 5 mg per kg. 0, 24, and 48 hours. So it can be taken with food once daily for 14 days. Rimaquine should be added in Vivax and Oval. What is the dose? It is 0.25 mg per kg body weight. Rimaquine is given to eradicate the gametocytes to prevent the spread of infection. ACT combined with Rimaquine for chloroquine resistant Vivax malaria. So other classification is, there are schizoncidal drugs or tissue schizoncidal drugs and gametocidal drugs. Blood schizoncidal drugs act on the erythrocytic stage of the parasite, whereas tissue schizoncidal drugs act on the primary tissue. Tissue forms of the plasmodium, not the blood forms. Whereas gametocidal drugs destroy the sexual forms of the parasite, thereby preventing the transmission of infection to the mosquitoes. So what are the blood schizoncidal drugs? They are quinine, artemisinin, chloroquine, lumefantrine, tetracycline. All these drugs are blood schizoncidal drugs. Whereas tissue schizoncidal drugs are rimaquine, pyrimethamine, proguanil, tetracycline. Commonly used drug is rimaquine. Gametocidal drugs are again rimaquine and artemisinin. So artemisinin has both blood schizoncidal effect and gametocidal effect. Quinine also. Rimaquine has both tissue schizoncidal and gametocidal effects. Hypnojointicidal drugs. They should be given in Vivax. So it is rimaquine and tafenoquine. Sporazonticidal drugs are again rimaquine, proguanil, chloroquine. So this is the flowchart we follow. Whenever there is a suspected case of clinical malaria, we have to do RDT or microscopy. If it is positive for falciparum, we have to. If it is severe malaria, we'll learn how to treat severe malaria. If it is uncomplicated malaria, treat with ACT combinations of chloroquine. If it is non-falciparum, you have to go ahead with chloroquine. If the microscopy or rapid test is negative, but signs are consistent with complicated malaria, then also you should not take any chance. You should give anti-malarial drugs. Even if the test is negative, if you strongly clinically feel that a patient has a complicated malaria, then you should not wait for the further results and you go ahead with anti-malarial treatment. So severe malaria is a medical emergency. So after rapid clinical assessment and confirmation of the diagnosis, we have to give intravenous anti-malarial treatment. So what are we giving here? Artesunate. dose is 2.4 milligram per kg body weight. IV or IM can be given. When is it given? At the time of admission, 0 hour, then 12 hours, 24 hours. 0, 12, 24. You should all remember this. Artesunate dose is 2.4 milligram per kg body weight. So the other alternative is quinine. If parenteral artesunates are not available, you can go ahead with quinine. What is the dose of quinine? It is 20 milligram per kg body weight at admission, and then 10 milligram per kg body weight every 8th hour. Infusion rate should be less than 5 milligram per kg body weight per hour. So the preferred regimen is IV artesunate. For a common patient, it will come around 60 milligrams. 2.4 milligram per kg will come to 60 milligrams at 0, 12 and 24, and then once daily for 7 days. Once the patient can tolerate the oral therapy, then we have to switch to oral therapy, artemether-lumefantrine combination for 3 days. So till the patient is able to take oral, we have to give IV artesunate. The artesunate is reconstituted with sodium bicarbonate, soda bicarbonate. Usually ceftriaxone and all other drugs are reconstituted normal saline, but this one artesunate is reconstituted with 5% soda bicarbonate. Then we can add D5R saline. Initially we have to add bicarbonate, and then we have to give saline. Slow IV injection with 3 to 4 ml per minute is injected into the anterior thigh, or you can give IV. Quinine is usually used in pregnant ladies also. Pregnant ladies, quinine is used to treat malaria. For uncomplicated malaria, these are the per kg body weight regimens. In different age groups, this is the treatment. It's not important. So if it is to children less than 5 kgs, then we have to give artesunate or quinine. IM first dose is 1.2 milligram per kg. Normal dose is 2.4. Now you have to give half the dose. The child age group is 0 to 4 and less than 5 kgs. So there will be mixed infections. Sometimes you will get two lines, both falciparum and Vivax will be positive in the cartridge. Then you have to treat for falciparum. So these are the special populations. Specific population like pregnancy, we have to give quinine plus clindamycin. Artesunate is secondary in pregnancy. Go ahead with quinine. Or lactating women, we can give standard treatment with ACT combinations. Some drugs cannot be used in lactating women, like primaquine, dapsone, and all. If there is a hepatic impairment, chloroquine should be given dose modified. 30 to 50% is by liver metabolism. So we have to decrease the dose. Chloroquine should also be reduced in renal impairment. Dose reduction should occur. Severe and complicated falciparum or Noel's malaria is a medical emergency that requires intervention and intensive care. Fluids should be given, electrolytes should be seen, glucose and acid balance should be maintained. If there is cerebral malaria, we have to monitor the consciousness level every day using Glasgow Coma Scale. There is hyperpyrexia, we have to give tepid sponging, cold sponging, fanning, antipyretic drugs like paracetamol. If there is seizure, we have to give diazepam, IV diazepam, 0.15 mg per kg. There is hypoglycemia, we have to give dextrose. Severe anemia is treated with packed cell transfusion. So So monitoring should be with blood smears. After treatment, you have to repeat the blood smear twice daily, daily twice in severe infection. Within 48 to 72 hours after starting treatment, patient will become afebrile. So prevention is better than cure. So better we avoid mosquito bites, wearing long sleeves and trousers, insecticide treated bed nets or repellent creams and sprays. So what is chemo prophylaxis? Someone is coming to some endemic area, some foreigner is coming to India, or some tribal area where malaria is very endemic, then they have to take chemo prophylaxis to prevent developing malaria. So it is by mefloquine 250 milligram weekly up to 1 year, or doxycycline 100 milligram daily up to 3 months. When should they start treatment? They should start treatment 1 week before and continue till 4 weeks after leaving the area. So basically for chemo prophylaxis, we can use mefloquine or doxycycline. So this is the dosage for mefloquine. In India, National Malaria Elimination Program is going on. In 1958, they started to eradicate malaria, but till now, it is a major cause of deaths. We cannot control malaria. Initially, they thought malaria disappeared completely, but again in 1970, it came back. So NAMP is revamped to. Initially, National Malaria Eradication Program is changed to NAMP, and finally now it is National Vector-Borne Disease Control Program, NVBDCP. That is the current program. WHO 2012 estimated 627,000 deaths, mostly in the African children. Mortality is reduced due to discovery of artist snake, but still it is very high. So there is a need for vaccine. When is World Malaria Day? It is 25th April. Thank you.